Teams are getting sick of seeing it. Like, he's just so good. He's so consistent. It's just obnoxious.
And it's not just the lifesteal. It's that then you have to ban Ricky in the second phase. A lot of teams are doing that consistently now because it's just such a hard-to-stop game.
Well, this is really interesting. Alliance banned the Wisp themselves. So both of the most commonly picked EGM heroes are gone from the pool.
Na'Vi immediately opts for the Slaughter.
That's quite a change-up. I don't really know who else first picks Slaughter. I think it's just MVP, right?
Well, it's Alliance's next most played hero. It goes Rubick and then Slaughter, 5 and 4 games respectively. They've played about 25 heroes in about 10 games, so they're variable here. But if they take their best hero, or maybe not their best hero, but it's a hero they have 75% win rate on. Loda plays it well. Oh, I'm so excited.
Jakiro is back.
I was just arguing
Red
with people.
Jakiro is back.
He was saying it last panel. And now he gets it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He's so happy.
I was just...
I said last night when we were going back to the hotel, there were two heroes that still haven't come out from teams that have told me they want to play. One was Jakiro with Alliance. One was Legion Commander with Complexed. And now we've got both within a game.
So that's 91 now.
It's 91 heroes.
Companion predictions are
getting
close to being ruined.
Yes, they are.
This is the team most likely to pick it, though. They played Jakiro at Epicenter. They had some good value with it. I'm just excited to see it. I just had an argument with people on Reddit that saying that Jakiro does have some value. They were just saying, oh, he's slow and you can dodge all his spells and stuff. There are situations when Jakiro is okay, and Faceless Void is one of them. It's guaranteed macro pyre damage. You can push lane. You provide attack speed slow and other utility. It's pretty okay.
The one question I've got for you though, is it too early here? Or do you not think they would have got it later on if they kind of played around it through the draft?
That's a really good point. It is a little early.
It does also leave their draft pretty open.
Very open.
It's a support pick. You're not revealing your cores unless they pull a DC and run it mid, but I highly doubt that they will. So, you know, very, very, still very flexible. Honestly, I'm just surprised that Purge spends time arguing with people on Reddit.
Don't you?
No.
No.
Charlie just tweets.
Good fun, man.
Let's people get on with it.
Gotta set people right. Jakiro's the way. They're also pretty happy that there's a Phoenix pick. Ice Path, really long range ability. They can interrupt Sunray without too much trouble there.
And yeah, the Phoenix came afterwards as well, so they obviously feel like that's not an issue for them.
Yeah, it might even have been part of the plan, like let Phoenix through, pick Jakiro,
well,
have
Sunray
that cover.
Sunray does have a longer range than Ice Path.
And Na'Vi's also been picking Phoenix pretty consistently. In
the last
three games they played, they picked either the Phoenix and the Mirana together, or just the Phoenix plus another core.
Yeah, it's also a mild block pick in a way, but... Yeah, Alliance have also been picking Alliance. It's their second most picked hero over the last 3 months, so it works both ways.
And another thing about the Void here, it's very likely going to be a carry Void. They do sometimes do offlane, but I think they're one of the teams that consistently does Faceless Void carry.
Yes.
We'll probably see something very similar there.
Chantress and Puck.
Oh, the Puck is banned, so we won't be seeing the Dream Puck.
That's good. We're also not going to see a TA.
Well, so. We're saving it for game 3, guys.
Oh, of course we are.
It's really important to point that out.
Yeah.
10 seconds. Bans, though, not out of the ordinary from what we expected. The Enchantress ban, it's very Na'Vi
art
oriented.
Style staple.
Art style staple.
Yeah, Knoxville just sent me a note saying that I can't actually repeat what he actually said, but just something my compendium predictions.
Okay.
I think you can guess.
I mean, does anybody... 90 heroes out of like 100?
91. That's 91 now.
What was the range for the actual prediction? It was 81 to 90 or something?
There were about 5 every level, starting at about 60 or something all the way up.
So everybody's is going to get ruined.
I think so. It's a good time for Dota.
This is
a perfect example of good meta balance. As a hero like Jakiro, who's sometimes good.
Yes.
And is different than other heroes.
We said this day one in the group stages, weren't we? Do you remember we were discussing about the fact that it's such a wide pool now and there's so many different things that you can counter with and come back against and then learn about it and then come back again, and it means that almost everything is within reason. Maybe Snub is a stretch, but almost every hero is viable.
And that's why I argue with people on Reddit, because that's the point. Jakiro shouldn't be made to be Crystal Maiden or Vengeful Spirit. You don't have to make his nukes reliable. You don't have to balance it around other heroes. You balance it around the fact that he has unique ability. He's slow because he has really high strength gain. And he has tons of AoE utility. There's very few supports that have as much AoE utility as Jakiro has, for example.
Look, Kevin,
good things about another
everybody.
One.
Oh!
Okay.
The Skywrath Mage
was
a big surprise. We've not seen it this tournament. It wasn't one of the heroes we thought might come out either. It's pick number 92.
But we actually were talking about it. It's not the most unexpected. We've been seeing the Voids all the time, and then we've been waiting for that Skywrath Mage.
It's great with a Void, but even more so, it's great against the Phoenix. Yeah. It's great against the Phoenix. You can Mystic Seal him, silence him, and it's great at zoning out offlaners. Something that we've really departed from is are those supports that are really good at like zoning out an offlaner by itself. Oftentimes, sometimes the support needs help. We saw that with the Lion and the Tide. The Tide just got way too many levels, but Skywrath is the king of zoning out offlaners.
Yeah, absolutely, and it's an Ake icon. He's been playing it not too much, of course, lately, but he used to play it a lot around the TI4 region.
Even in times when Skywrath Mage was definitely being pushed out of the meta and wasn't being played anymore, Alliance was one of the few teams to actually play him consistently.
Yeah. Oh, and the Brood comes out now.
I think that's in response to the Chen.
Okay, it's in some ways bad against Slaughter, though. If you blink Dust, you can amp him. Very easy to kill then.
But in those early stages, Brute is still going to apply a lot of pressure here. Slardar doesn't really do anything against that. If you put the Brute against the Slardar, he's going to play off the back foot, and Slardar doesn't do well catching up. He's going to have a delayed blink dagger. He's not going to be that initiator that can counter the Brute.
Keep looking through your book, Dendi. This one's not in there.
Definitely not.
Are you talking about a Brood Slar 1v1? Or are you just saying, like, where are you assuming the Slaughter's going?
Okay, this is the beauty of Alliance's draft right now. If the Brood is in a 1v1 or even a 1v2 against the Slardar, Brood should come out ahead. If you think about it, it's a Chen. So he's not going to be able to do much against the Brood. And it's going to be Phoenix. A Phoenix zoning out a Brood? No, Brood destroys that lane. If it's a Slardar in the offlane, Skywrath Mage destroys that.
Okay.
So that's the response to the Broodmother.
Game on then.
We saw LGD do that earlier today.
It works okay, but they have silence on Skywrath Mage. They have tons of nukes between Jakiro Sky, Faceless Void, a lot of magic damage.
Time dilation versus Timbersaw is quite devastating.
Got another question for you that was sort of sent to me via social media, which sort of fits this, not quite, but why isn't Silencer being used very much?
Too cooldown dependent. I think his basic skills are actually pretty good. Alliance is the most likely team to pick it. They have picked it, but it's just safer to go for other supports.
I also don't particularly like the new version of Arcane Curse.
I personally like it.
Yeah, I like the one point of it because of course it's very good versus stopping blinks and everything, but it just doesn't seem like it has that power that it used to, that obnoxiousness.
It just feels like it might fit the counter to what we're seeing a lot of, so just, you know, one of those questions, why didn't it come up?
I think it's just like super cooldown dependent. Yeah, if you look at all the other teams, or the meta for all the other games, it's about just running at you constantly. Silencer's awful against that. Yeah. That cooldown on the ultimate is so long.
Yeah.
Okay, fifth picks still to come. One more ban. The Invoker is out from the lights. Yeah. Very interesting draft. One of the more interesting drafts we've had at the Major, actually.
Massive change-ups across both. Yeah. They ban out the Lesh, they have the Queen of Pain,
It's gotta be a BKB mid.
Queen of Pain, Windrunner...
Tinker's banned. I think those are the two big ones that stand out to me.
I mean, most of Alliance is magic damage right now. So, something that's like a BKB core, I feel like is the most obvious progression. I don't necessarily want to see Dendi playing Dragon Knight or something like that, but but they need that kind of a solution, I think.
Especially because they have the Chen. I was thinking how it complements it very well, and they kind of, besides the Chen, they kind of lack push.
Yeah, exactly. Death Prophet would have been my call. But
it's gone. Also banned.
Yep.
Yep.
So they go for the Windrunner that you were talking about. So that's.
I kind of like this. It's pretty weak disable on Alliance. Like, they have slows and things, but
it also synergizes really with Slardar. Really well.
Good point.
Back to what Seeker was doing it at.
And he's got Windrun versus Faceless Void, so Void's going to consistently have to chrono. If he pops Windrun as he chronos, then Void has to completely rely on the magic damage to get kills. It's actually a pretty good pick here. I like it.
Right. So, where do we go in the mystery draft that is Alliance's draft this time around?
If they go by standard stuff, again, there is the Queen of Pain, there's the Dragonite, which they like a lot. It synergizes with the Jakiro and the Broodmother. But
if not standard,
we might just see, I don't know, something completely
They've been taking a lot of Lesh. Lesh isn't that good.
Lesh is banned. There's so many mid heroes that are banned already, and I think Na'Vi probably took the best mid hero that for Alliance. I think Windrunner would have been
What about the Corpse
Alliance
pick?
The what?
The Queen of Pain.
I think
it's okay,
well.
But like Fog said, it's a lot of magic damage.
Yeah. Once they get like a pipe or two, it's their damage is over.
But really, where else do we go?
Viper, DK.
Yeah, okay.
Yep. Zerhero's S4 does not have the best win rates on. They played Dragonite 3 times, kind of the similar thing. They've lost 3 games.
Yeah.
I think he needs something that's more playmaking. He's got to be able to create space, get things done. It's not just about tanking up and pushing towers.
He's going to use all that time in that booth as well, isn't he?
Well, they got about 30 seconds to make their pick, so they've got a lot of deliberation to do.
Those are the ones that we listed are pretty much everything that they've picked recently. Unless it's a Batrider, yeah, Batrider could be.
It combos well with Skywrath Mage, they can use it with Macro Pyre.
But then it's still
full
more,
space maker.
It's full space maker, and again, it's still a lot of magic damage, and Batrider or the other cores don't have a great game.
There's no
follow-up, yeah, exactly.
It does give them a bit of deep. Okay, they do go for the Dragonite. It synergizes so well with the Jakiro.
But
it does.
As you rightly pointed out, it hasn't been the most successful hero for S4 either. Yeah.
Doesn't match his playstyle super well, but I think they had to pick it.
And it gives him another form of lockdown, which...
Yeah,
okay. Very quickly, let's go down the line. Who's had the better draft? If you can decipher it, Charlie.
Ooh. I like Navi's draft a lot here.
Okay. More standard? Fogged?
I like Alliance's draft, honestly. I really do like Alliance's draft. I think they have a little bit more synergy across their heroes.
Right. And Perch, finally, with you?
Yeah, I think I like the Alliance draft a little bit better. I think the pieces fit together better than Navi's does.
Okay. Time to find out then, because the wacky draft versus the more standard one. You wouldn't believe who it was. Alliance versus Navi, game 1 is about to begin. LD and Melini, it's all yours.
Thank you very much, Paul. That's right, we're live here. And Ben, I have to say, coming into the Manila Majors, so many fans out there, they were really excited for EG versus Secret, but as it turns out, El Trashico is not happening. It's El Clasico, Navi versus Alliance, a timeless story. Let's get into it. I didn't have it up tight. That's right, folks. Alliance versus Navi, a tale as old as time, a classic battle. Some new faces on the Navi side, Ben, but a very, very just dynastic matchup here.
A lot of old school stuff going on here. Faceless Void and Skywrath, something that we haven't seen too much, maybe at TI4, but Alliance does like to pull it out now and then. Bulldog doesn't want to be matched up versus the Timbersaw, but doesn't look like they're trying to dodge that matchup at all.
So I want to get your thoughts quickly on the draft here, Ben, before we get too far into the lane. So the panel seemed like the edge was going slightly to Alliance. Do you buy that, or are you feeling it more for Navi?
Their point was more that there's much more synergy between like Faceless Void with the Skywrath and the Jakiro, even the Dragon Tail with those two. Navi, you really only have the synergy with the Windranger and the Slardar. Timber is just the Brood counter, and then Shen is just one of Artstyle's best heroes. Same with Sunako on the Phoenix. So I agree that I see more synergy in Alliance's teamfight composition.
All right, let's see how they're able to execute it as the runes begin to spawn here. We will see just a 1v1 at the bottom, a big duel that could have happened, won't actually materialize. It's an easy grab here, a double for Na'Vi, uncontested. They start the game off with 2 bounty runes, Alliance forfeiting them. Not as important as they used to be without the experience, but that is still a nice little boon to get this game underway.
Okay, they did move Admiral Bulldog onto the top lane, but with the Observer Ward scouting out the Timbersaw, they have moved Admiral Bulldog down to the bottom. So this is... you don't want your Brood to be matchup versus the Timbersaw at all. I think regardless of what build the Brood goes, the no Broodling or the Spiderling build, you will still lose.
Alrighty, the Sentry getting planted down here in the lane as always. Looks like Coplate actually 3 heroes very aggressively after the Timbersaw, but he's just going to hang back. So yeah, we'll take a look at all the lanes. Dityara holding serve in the top lane. He's getting offensive trailing by a Void. Not something you used to see, well, really have ever seen much of, but Alliance, they've been the one team in this event that actually run aggressive tri-lanes, and they had some success with it against Mineski. Thoughts on the way they're setting this up?
I like how they're positioning. They have EGM on the right side because he has armor and he has a lot more strength. So if the Chen comes in, EGM will be the first one to scatter out, not the vulnerable Skywrath. So I think they're, because the Chen does have a smoke, he is looking to neutralize the pressure of this tri-lane. But with EGM over there and Loda right behind him, I don't really think they can get a kill with the Chen.
And I have to say, for Na'Vi, that's where they've had their best games, is when Artstyle is playing that aggressive jungler, someone who can create a lot of space in the early to mid game. up until now, that's been where Navi's had their greatest success. So we'll see if he's able to deliver. For now, though, that ward might make it difficult to move towards the top side of the map. And Dierra finds himself on a bit of an island. Alliance with quite a bit of kill potential, a lot of magic damage here, and the silence. But haven't tried to make a go on him just yet so far, playing it very defensively. And as we take a look at mid, we can see Dragon Knight not having the easiest time thus far. But S4, he's getting his levels. That's really all he cares about. As the runes come out, 2 minutes. Still a quiet game thus far. Sineko snagging another bounty rune. That's two in a row for him. And he's even starts punching Ake, forces him back a bit. Navi with the clean sweep on the first two sets of runes. Alliance just don't care about them.
Slaughter is getting a lot of farm in the bottom lane. He was just ahead of Admiral Bulldog in CS until he left the lane for about 30, 40 seconds to get that rune. It's not an easy lane for Slaughter.
Yeah, definitely. Being left to the wolves, but Art Style looks like might be making his first move now as they prepare for a likely smoke up towards the top side of the map. We can see S4 just hanging out in the mid lane and taking a look at what's going on. Top to Yara, posting up a little bit here. They are wrapping the Chen around south from the river, from behind. From the north comes the Phoenix, the Timber just baiting, and Alliance are about to be caught totally unawares. There's the jump in, EGM, eat the Sunray, meet the Centaur, and easy first blood. Navi, as always, Art Style, he's on point on the junglers.
Navi playing pretty riskily. A lot of times with the Chen or Enchantress, you'll have a Sentry Ward just to make sure that your first smoke gank is not popped. And Navi, pays off for them.
Yeah, and with that, looking their farm here. Not doing so hot on the Timbersaw. We do see Bulldog and Loda on the Void and the Broodmother respectively. They're topping the CS charts, but at the same time, Navi not getting completely destroyed in the lane. They do have the Chen factor. Dendi getting his customary heavy denies as Sineko moves in mid, offers that assistance that he seems to bring to the mid lane almost every game. And I think one of the big reasons why Navi loved the Phoenix is it could just do so much to zone out these 1v1 matchups.
Navi's just moving everyone around Sneko to the mid lane, and we see Ditya Ra move down to the bottom lane.
Shackle mid, there's the swoop forward, Icarus dive, and then they're gonna chase this one a bit. The Sunray comes out, round two. S4, will he dodge the power shot? He can't! Dendi pierces his armor and shuts him down. Sneko just making plays, as always, in the laning stage for Navi.
S4 did a really good job of trying to dodge that shot, but Dendi,
he juked himself, you know, he ran right, he ran left, he ended up in the middle, and Dendi nailed it. So it was a good effort.
I wonder where General's supposed to find farm. He got left to the wolves in the bottom lane, just against a solo Broodmother. Now that Broodmother is level 5, it's a very problematic lane for a hero that doesn't have that much AoE. And the top lane is constantly...
Oh, okay, he's trying to answer Sineko, but they actually had detection for him as he roams through mid. Not realizing the sentry was there. He'll make it out. But a missed opportunity for a potential kill. And going back to your point about the Slardar here, I guess they're going to try to do it with just aggression. They run onto EGM looking for the crush. He's going to hold it. He recalculates, then he lets it fly. They get off the follow-up stomp and the Hadouken Art Style. Very good micro here, but he might end up going down anyway to the nukes of EGM. That twin head is awful tanky. General finding that secondary stun. And Miwa on the mid lane. Dendi's also gone down. Alliance firing back. Make it 2-3 as they can't run down Loda, who skates away. So S4, looks like he did end up getting help on the second pass there from Ake Skyrath, the second time proving to be the charm. So they're gonna bring Sneko back in mid to get a bit of experience, but quietly, Bulldog is farming. 34 CS in the safe lane. You know, you look at a Broodmother farming, sometimes the Brood falls off later on, but Bulldog, on every game I've seen on the Brood, he's had impact even 40, 50 minutes in this tournament, Ben.
Yeah, he does seem to farm and scale really well in the Broodmother, where a lot of them just fall short at their laning phase. And
what do you think, like, separates? Is it the item build? Is it the decision making?
A little bit of both.
Okay.
More so the item build. That's just the type of player he is. Someone that won't fall off.
Shackle mid. They found S4 again. Power shots there. The magic damage really raining in on S4, but not enough to finish the kill. They will force him back, but he just bottles up and calmly moves towards the rune spawn. See if Navi are able to get another round for themselves.
And now Alliance trying to counter the greed of the Chen by moving one of their own heroes into jungle, Admiral Bulldog, farming up, and switching Skywrath Mage to farm that lane versus the Timbersaw.
So let's talk a little bit more about the mid-game here. We're heading towards the tail end of the laning stage. Dragon Knight's hit level 6. Chen's gone first few smoke ganks. We've seen some lane swaps. You mentioned Slaughter needs to catch up. What are the next couple of minutes, 5 to 10 or so, looking like for each team?
if Na'Vi can have a really tanky hero that can withstand like a Dragon Tail into a Skywrath Ultimate or a Chronosphere into a Mystic Flare, then they'll be willing to fight Alliance 515. Otherwise, just try and get quick picks with Windranger, get that early blink up on Slardar, and go for surgical maneuvers around the map as opposed to large-scale battles.
Well, Art Style, he's looking to be very aggressive here top, roaming through the river. The surgery is perhaps not to the liking of Loda. This is an unwilling patient that he moves after, but EGM probably the easier target. Let's see who they go on. It is Loda! Stop! Oh, he just barely dodges it. So they're going to go back for the easier, lower-hanging fruit of the kill. But Art Style kinds of finds himself surrounded by his own creeps, and Loda just runs back in on him. General crept out of the trees. Not exactly the smoothest gank from Na'Vi, but they do end up getting the twin head in the end. Some additional damage taken there, and Loda will back away, unable to save his buddy. So despite being a very tanky support, then this twin head still racking up the deaths.
It's because they know that the Broodmother is very static. DK is somewhat static. Usually he's more the aggressor, like you TP to a lane and then you get a kill, but he's not terribly great at counter ganking just because you want him to be park mid and get that tower down as soon as possible. But Broodmother not going to move from bottom for the next 15 or 20 minutes likely.
And you've got a Dragon Knight mid who has now hit level 6, cracking level 7 even, and he may not move, just going to pop the ultimate, chip on the tower, and it seems Alliance are pretty content with a static laning stage, even towards the tail end of when they normally break down, but Na'Vi, they don't like that. They're even roaming now, the Slardar, looking towards the top rune. They want to fight this out. The Shackle comes through from the low ground. The follow-up's there from Zaneko with the balanced Ray and S4. He tries to make it out. He's so low, but not good enough. The Firebird wins again.
I wonder what Zaneko's win rate on that hero is.
It's not just his, like, he wins the mid lane no matter what the matchup is, no matter how much help the enemy team gives to their own mid. So consistently. And then you look towards the mid game, can have a lot of impact, and again, it's on to top. The bubble gets dropped, but EGM shackled outside of it, can't follow it up with any sort of damage. He could be in danger here. Art Style turning back towards him. The fire, the Hadouken onto EGM. They continue to ramp up the damage. Backup not in sight. Loda again throws EGM to the horde of Na'Vi, who continue to just descend on this lane. They get another kill. And while this is happening, Timbersaw getting some free farm bottom. It's actually Alliance moving three towards mid. They feel like they have to get an objective, Ben.
Right now, it doesn't seem like Brood has a place in this game. She can't lane versus Timbersaw. You can't push versus the Slardar, and you can't defend any of these ganks that Na'Vi are pushing around.
The Yara, perhaps a bit too bold here. He comes in, he tries for the tower deny. That won't happen. But again, it's Zaneko. Back to the party. He's got an egg already. Only 9 minutes in. He'll drop it. Shackle. Oh, a bit off the mark. Could have been a huge setup on two heroes. Still Na'Vi are chasing. They really hunt for these kills. They dive deep on Ake. They want that Skywrath Mage. They get him too. And Zaneko healing to Yara all the while. However, he will fall as the trade. A one for one. Bit unpolished there. A bit sloppy, but Na'Vi will retreat fairly safely, so it's a Timbersaw for a Skywrath, but Alliance do get the tower mid in the end, and Na'Vi unable to take a tier 1 of their own.
And they're making good use of the DK. They could have picked something like a Queen of Pain. It was still available on the map, but looking to push down those towers very early with the dual threat of the Broodmother and the Dragon Knight. Bulldog has committed for a hand of Midas.
Bulldog, he's definitely not afraid to take this lane, even if he is a Brood. He's shown that hero can scale quite well, but EGM, he's a punching bag at this point. Another death for him. Just gets pummeled time after time by Na'Vi, but he is drawing 3-4 TPs or rotations every time he dies, and all the while, we see Broodmother farming the jungle. We do see Loda in the offlane farming exceptionally well, but looks like he might be going towards a bigger item, saving up to 1,900 gold now. So, do you feel it's enough space created to justify all the deaths?
I don't think so. Zaneko's getting out of control. He's level 7.5. I think he was level 6 at 8 minutes, which was faster than General on the Slardar. On top of that, Na'Vi have an excellent Roche lineup with the Slardar, and Windranger is a very, very good Aegis carrier in this game, especially when you can just sack her in exchange for a Chrono and a Mystic Flare. So I'm pretty worried about Alliance's mid-game, unless they make a move right now.
The double smoke, both teams moving in. Alliance on the low ground, Na'Vi have the high ground positioning. They don't have the blink yet on the Slardar, though. He's about 600 gold short or so, and it's at who ends up ambushing Snake, but long blast, the Phoenix dies at the start of a fight. That is a whole lot sweeter. Loda being chain stunned, completely controlled for now by Artsell. He does get the time walk off, but he's running for dear life. He has a Chrono, doesn't want to waste it defensively. He will be able to disengage. A close call there, but all the while, Bulldog, well, might not lane well against the Timber, but he's been left alone bottom, and he takes full advantage. Grabs the tower, a secondary one for Alliance, who have done a really good job. You look at the Mineski series, they would often, if they didn't feel like they could take fights, or even if they do, they hedge their bets by taking an objective elsewhere. And they do it again now.
Yep, usually they will not be able to get such an easy kill on the Phoenix. I wonder what type of tool that Dragonite is going to go for. It looks like the Armlet first, not sure if it will be a Blink or Shadow Blade after that. Maybe even a BKB will be warranted this game versus the Timbersaw.
Yeah, I guess they're going to have a Slardar Blink Dagger on the side of Na'Vi soon, so for them, is that the key item they're lacking? Oh, Loda. Getting caught out here. He will just time walk and retreat. Alliance feeling very confident as that rune is about to spawn. S4 down in the river. That Jekyll doesn't end up connecting. Looked like it might, but Dendi couldn't quite find the angle. Still, they burn S4 down. Power shot. He did have a bit of extra regen there. Pops the stick, pops the bottle. Now they want to turn. Sineko overextending again. That's twice now he's gotten punished. And meanwhile, Chen also roasting as EGM massacres the creep army. Na'Vi firmly on the back foot after this last sequence of events. They might lose a third hero. Arcsight will end up dropping to the rotation of Ake. That's a 3-for-nothing exchange. This Bulldog gets active here too, rotating towards the mid lane. May retreat to his home and hibernate a bit in bottom, but you can see that Alliance are just in control right now in pretty much every department. Almost a 7,500 gold lead at only 13 minutes in.
I don't think they're seeking out the Broodmother enough. Broodmother is extremely weak at this point. Well, now she has Echo Saber, but not that much HP. Hand of Minus, she's just a walking sack of gold at this point. And if you get her Spider Links too, that might be 3,000 gold for just one kill on the side of Na'Vi. However, without the Blink Dagger, there is not that big of a threat for Broodmother.
Yeah, General still trying to cobble it together. Never ended up going for the completed Iron Talon, and it has been a very slow farm game on him, but he is closing in on it now. We see him at 13 minutes, only about 400 gold away or so, but still a little bit to go, and Alliance not really afraid of that as we see confident split pushing both top and bottom, spreading the map, really pulling Na'Vi apart at the seams. And this is that stage of the game, Ben, where if Chen is playing defense, he is just not your ideal hero to have.
The Timbersaw is not very farmed. He has 960 HP right now with the cloak, but that's not really a problem for Alliance, who can easily chrono him. You want to get to the point where Na'Vi, they aren't scared to walk up to the void. Right now, if anyone sees a void, they just have to immediately back out of the fight.
So Na'Vi waiting on the blink, it seems. That's really the key at this point. Bulldog did grab the Echo Saber, up to another 1,300 gold now. Still creeping on the bottom lane. Beyond the blink, anything else that Na'Vi can do to get back into this game? You mentioned
just a lot more farmers.
Great Rosh potential. Can they try to sneak a Rosh right now? Is that too risky?
I don't think they can. Broodmother is already sending one Spiderite into the pit, so they can constantly keep tabs on there, and Bulldog has a great set of webs.
And another jungle invasion play now is Alliance. You can see just to the south of Arcsile creeping into the woods.
Dire needs a scan on the two smoked heroes. They know that they're there.
Maybe scouts to the south. They are playing very far back. The mech now complete, but still S4 creeping forward, wanting to go in. Not going to end up committing to this. And they do send the Dragonite just back towards the mid lane now. So Alliance whiffing on the smoke there, but you can still see the general positioning they have. They feel like they can posture up, post up in the in the Na'Vi woods, play aggressively. They're not really afraid of any sort of counterplay, and Na'Vi maybe going to punish them for that now as we see them grouping up towards the bottom rune, but it's into the Rosh pit they go.
He is double Timbersaw's net worth right now, Admiral Bulldog is. So you have the offlaner who's double the other opposing offlaner's net worth. You have the Faceless Void who's pretty close to double Slaughter's net worth, and they really need kills on one of those two cores.
They are trying for the Roshan, but Alliance are having none of it. And now he's fairly low. Bulldog's going to send the army in, see what's going on. They find a Rosh at half HP. Do they just try to take it right away? Na'Vi, General's going to jump. He gets the initiation off on Ake. This is the Blink Dagger debut. It nets them an Ake kill. Does Loda want a counterplay? Shackle coming through, won't connect on EGM. Where's that chrono? It's a pretty good one, but the egg's on top of it. So Alliance don't want to walk in. This is going to completely waste the Chronosphere. Na'Vi now, Rosh at half HP. Bulldog being forced back a bit. They get the amp damage on him. A Bulldog kill would be huge. They crush him. They latch onto him. Can they focus him down? Chasing a bit further.
He gets up one auto attack. EGM now finds himself on an island as his Bulldog again retreating. Dendi just fishing, looking for the follow-up action here. Navi finding their customary aggression, waving with an awful lady. There's the tackle from Dendi, and they find the S4 kill. Make it 11-7. They're not done just yet. On the Lodo they go. Sunray coming through as the Time Walk does get it off, but they can potentially still chase this. He's still in range for a bit of additional damage. Trying. Good job there with the time dilation, but still the Blade Crush comes out. General will get another kill for the team. 12-7 now the score, as four Alliance heroes, including the Skywrath earlier, hit the deck. A complete coup d'etat from Navi, who will now also, on top of that 3,000 gold swing, they get the Roach as well.
So Nico with a godly supernova. If he didn't have that supernova, I think they were in line for a three-man macro pyre and an ice bath.
Instead, they had nothing.
If they commit to that, they all get wiped by the supernova.
Well, Soneko, he gave up those two deaths, but he was huge in the early late stage, and he's been really big here into the crucial mid-game moments. On the back of that, going to get a nice tome of experience. He's going to potentially pay with his life. Sunrain going for the TP. See you later, Bulldog! I'm out of here! Oh, just toying with the dong. Sick stuff.
Sick stuff indeed. Alliance, they do have a good amount of farming items. Stasis Void, not going for a super tanky build. Maelstrom up on him. Midas already up on Bulldog.
Bulldog, he's out pretty far here, Ben. The crush comes through. Is there any follow-up, though? It's a slow-marching Chen army that looks to join General. I think they were hoping Bulldog would finish farming that wave. He does make it out, but feels like they're starting to get a little more pressure on Bulldog. Limit him a bit. Alliance turning their sights elsewhere. They see Navi congregating bottom, and they send four to the mid lane. They even rotate the Brood away, so they're basically willing to give up this tower and go for two of their own.
I wonder if Sunray was going to be enough to stop that. I wonder what General is going to go for. He has 1,700 gold after, and at this point, it seems to him as if Alliance are going to keep dodging fights, so what does he want to commit for? If you're fighting a lot, then Four Staff is pretty darn good. Sometimes we see like a Pipe or a BKB. Midas is an option for him. Armlet.
Yet another smoke from Na'Vi. Alliance already getting nervous. They're backing out. There's the quick time walk away, but Dendi, he's hasted, racing after Loda, thinking about a Chrono. He hesitates, fishing for the angle. Dendi, he doesn't get it. No latch for you, sir, but instead, they might get EGM. He's on the run once more. The star crossed. Jakiro drops, but hey, I guess at this point, it's probably the best kill to be giving up.
Alliance are still farming faster than Na'Vi can kill them, possessing a 3k gold lead, most of it due to Broodmother.
Well, you say that, but the graphs are tipping a bit here. It's definitely equalized, Ben.
Yeah.
And they're just waiting for that one explosive fight now as they're playing a lot more offense. We see them going for smokes, not afraid to run after Bulldog, and they still hold the Aegis here. Got a couple of minutes to work with, about 2.5 or so. And they are pushing for towers. They got the tier 1 bottom earlier, courtesy of the Chen army, and now Na'Vi, they set their sights on the top lane. Dendi slowly poking at this one. But Alliance are mustering the defense. Loda in position. Doesn't have the Blink Dagger. He's more that one position Void here. He's gone for a Maelstrom Yasha build. Looks like he was even considering a Vlad's at one point. So, all over the place, but mostly focused on the carry Void. And it looks like Alliance, they think about the tower defense, and then they decide to let it go.
The kill score looks bad for Alliance, but seven of the deaths are on the Jakiro.
That's impressive.
It is.
EGM's been practicing. Taking a page out of Pylight Eye's book, but it does seem like, for the most part, it's been for a good cause. Last fight, we see the...
I don't want to read that book, Kilby.
It's a depressing tale. Better told from the core's point of view, not so much from his.
So it looks like maybe they don't want to fight until BKBs. Still, most of the other heroes, aside from the DK, lack the problem of armor. Armor going to be a huge issue versus the Windranger Focus Fire, the Loda, the Amp from the Sardar. So I'm not sure if Broodmother or Faces Void are going to go for maybe Vlad's AC at some point.
Yeah, still hanging on to some gold here. We did see Bulldog grab the BKB, so has been a pretty early pickup for him in most of his games. Seems like he really wants to fight on the Brood in the mid game.
He's been kind of fortunate that some of the Shackles haven't lashed on him. If a Shackle hits on him, it's almost guaranteed.
It gets a lot harder now, though. Dendi's got the Blink. They have the Blink on the Slardar. And Na'Vi are starting to get more wards up here, or at least have the opportunity to do so. We see the one deep ward in the top lane. Probably can drop one off in the Radiant Jungle after taking this tower mid. They're getting more map control with this Aegis.
And a lot of time how we see Alliance deal with this sort of initiation.
Oh, my babies! Like Bulldog, take better care of your
Blink Stun from Sardar or like a Blink Shackle from Windranger's mass board staff, but they don't have any
farm. The blink, the jump onto S4, there's no save, there's no counterplay. Your tanky mid lane Dragon Knight just gets eviscerated, and Na'Vi surging back into pole position in this one. Now look for the tier 2 mid. EGM can do not but watch, unless he wants to give away death number 8.
It's going to be a slow siege on the T3 if they go for no Scepter up on Dendi.
Na'Vi just making all the right calls here, and it began with that Roche fight from a very significant deficit, but Spineko now closing in on the hand of Midas, up to 1700 gold.
Bulldog almost got General. He went for a Shadow Blade and going back in for round two.
Round two, fight. This one's a Shackle. Dendi's still got the DD, just chunks him down, pops the BKB, and the ultimate belt. Windrun says, you can't lifesteal from me. And Dendi gets the last laugh. Again, burning down Bulldog, finds himself now on a mega kill streak. This Broodmother not having the impact that we've seen from Bulldog in previous games this event.
Yeah, and that was...
despite the net worth.
That's a kill that will tip Na'Vi into the net worth lead at long last.
The tables have turned.
I don't know where
what's
Ruth's
next for Alliance.
Place in this game is. She was supposed to do a decent amount of damage in the laning phase, but she was matched up versus the Timbersaw, and then later the Sardar, and now she has a lot of farm on the Broodmother, but you get amped during a team fight with BKB on, you're still gonna perish. Like I don't see how he's supposed to man up.
Yeah, and you've got a core in Timbersaw who's very tanky. The Windranger is Windrun, so to get MKB, can't really deal with him. Not easy to find a target to lock onto unless you have an Immaculate Chrono, and we've barely seen a Chrono this game, and the really good one that we did from Loda, there was an egg there, so they weren't able to follow up on it.
Well, if there's a Broodmother that can deal with this, I think it will be Bulldogs.
General trying to avoid any opportunity for that. He Shadow Blades in deep on the bottom lane. He pings out S4 immediately. This could be awkward timing for Na'Vi though, because the whole Alliance Horde is coming in. They think about a retreat now. Sineko, a casual swoop through, and then a quick jump back, even popping the tactical smoke on the retreat. But Bulldog, ooh, that Brood racing after him. Not going to commit fully. Dendi now activating the regen rune. Na'Vi, they may end up disengaging here.
Right now, they definitely know that he has BKB. Maybe before that, they were willing to take a fight, but after seeing the BKB out on Brood, it's very unlikely that they want to go that deep onto the Brood.
Na'Vi are flexing their muscles now. They bring in the upgraded Ancient Creeps on the back of that Chen Ags, and they will commence a bit of siege here. We'll see how aggressively they want to push their advantage now, and again, a deep flank coming in. It's from the Slardar, from behind Alliance. It might be a triple crush if they're not careful. Will General get the jump? Doesn't look like it. The Chrono comes out first. Isolate Singer out. The egg gets focused down. Alliance executing much better this time. General a bit late to the party there. Not able to help his team. And Dingira on his own, but Dendi still finding counter kills. They brought down the Void. Bulldog has to turn tail and run as the BKB has ended. Dendi continues to land into him. He'll blink out. A 2-for-1 there, but EGM, oh, again and again. This poor Jakiro. Left of the Chen Creeps is being saved a bit by the team. He may actually live through a fight. Hoo-ah for EGM, he makes it out. Artstyle now trying to retreat the creep army out, it looks like, and send home some teammates. He will get Dendi out of there safely. Now he finds himself on an island, gets slowed down, nuked down, and brought down. That is not the ideal fight for Na'Vi. They give up 3 kills in Alliance. They just didn't get the Slardar initiation they were looking for.
Nope. And Timbersaw, I think he tanked everything in that fight. He has a hood, he popped it right before the Mystic Flare.
Oh, okay, the quick draw in general. He's just pressing. Bit frustrated perhaps with the way that fight went. Felt like he had to make a play for the team and ends up giving them another kill.
Yep. They do have a lot of farm though. Chen especially, I think with the Aghanim Scepter, is going to be a big factor with all those ancient auras coming in.
It's just such an interesting pace from Na'Vi. It's like their customary kind of breakneck Dota where they're like desperately searching for follow-up kills, diving deep. Like they see one here low, they say, all right, you guys in the back deal with him. We want to find that next target. At times it seems it does lead to overextending. Alliance much more reactionary, much more of a defensive posture, a very kind of classic offense versus defense dynamic developing in this game.
Now, Phoenix does not have the defensive items to deal with one stun. Going for the Team Vlads, no Midas Shivas or even Ags that we see sometimes from Sineko. He is definitely the highest priority target from Alliance.
So he opts not to go for the Midas here in the end, Ben.
Yeah, that's why I'm a little bit worried for Sineko.
Do you think this should have just been a Midas regardless of
So obviously he feels like he needs to contribute more now, but
I think
you're trading off some of your mid and late.
They traded him for the Chen's eggs. So I think the Chen's eggs is much safer in teamfights. Those creeps are very unlikely to die and provides persistent help throughout all the teamfights. And they can split push out the lanes. I still would like to see Phoenix scale in case the game goes late, picking up the Scepter to save someone from a Chronosphere Mystic Flare combo, even something as simple as a Dragon Tail.
All right, Alliance, they know this rush is happening. They've got a couple of Spiderites in the pit, but they're too late. And General does see Loda, gets the crush, finds the amp. Dendi's there as well with the Shackle. Navi clicks the strike. They draw first blood of this engagement, and now they move back towards Ake, but oh, Sineko very low. He gets duped up, healed by Archstyle. Ake gonna fall too. They keep Sineko in fighting shape. In general, this is what I'm talking about with Navi. They hunt for the backliners. They want those extra kills. They're on a power play. There's the Shackle and the crush combo. S4 just completely controlled by Archstyle. Now will end up going down, and General hunting for the fourth kill. EGM all the way back to the base. He's dodged that eight death for a while, Ben, but still a costly turn of events. Alliance very late to the Roche pit, despite having the vision inside.
And this is why Slaughter, I think, might be first pick a lot more often. It's just because the...
Especially Dire.
Yeah, it's just the Roche. They didn't have enough time to set up. That fight was lost simply because they didn't have sentries down at the start of the fight. Faceless Void gets scouted out by the Invis. Slaughter gets jumped and then just dies. But the supports didn't have time to set up there. They barely got a whip of them with the Broodmother Spiderites and just scrambling everything to hastily defend the Roche.
And good news, EGM lived.
Is that good? I think things go better for them if he dies.
All right, EGM, go commit seppuku down the middle lane. It seems to be a winning strategy as opposed to this. Still, Alliance losing ground here. They're down to just two tier twos, and it's more the momentum than anything else. As we've seen the Timbersaw pull his way back into this game. Archstyle up there in the top five in net worth, sort of a bit farther behind, but it's really like a quad core for Navi at this stage. Pretty late in the game for a Chen to still be that high up when it comes to net worth.
The bigger problem I see for Alliance is that the DK is not a big threat. He doesn't have any mobility items. He has a BKB, but this is only good if Navi actually jump Alliance. How do Alliance jump Navi? They need the Faceless Void to get in with a Chronosphere, but he has no blink. He went for the Mantis style to deal with the amp damage, perhaps make it a little bit more difficult for the Windranger to shackle, but if he's dead, there's no team fight. Whereas Navi, they have the Blink Shackle, they have multiple Blink Slithering Crushes, very low cooldown from both of these heroes. They can just engage again and again, whereas Alliance just maybe once every couple of minutes.
They're really building up their sustainability. Timbersaw already naturally tanky, now grabs a Hood. I can only imagine a Pipe will be in the cards at some point this game. Windranger has the Aegis, has the Chen backing them up with the Ag, so everyone on Navi just getting more and more durable, and more resistant to that Wombo combo, and oh, by the way, they have the Sun, right? Radiant's bottom we call it the balance down. Right here.
Yeah.
It keeps everything in check. Navi posting up bottom now. Four heroes here. They've already taken down the tier two. They're going to at least poke here on the high ground. Dendi, the man in front. A little bit over halfway to that Aghanim Scepter.
Still a very slow siege without Scepter, and he went for a very unusual build. Scepter 4, it looks like.
They do get a nice path on Dendi, but he continues to prod, and Sunray there to heal him up. Will also slowly work on this creep army. Dira coming in, General. Oh, he finds that first amp. Just giving them the vision up the hill that they need to threaten Alliance a bit more. Loda was split pushing top lane, but
where
he's come home.
Sentries? They need to deward this high ground observer ward. Okay, there it goes.
Still Navi. Half damage done to this tower. The fire dragon working on the creep wave. We'll bring down Ancient Black Dragon. Up in front. Very tanky. They'll heal up Dendi. They still have two Ancient Creeps here. Alliance just very reluctant to fight head on into this, but there's no split push. There's no flank. There's only slight creep pressure top. There's nothing to draw Navi back for at least a couple of minutes until this Aegis expires.
Their damage is really slow without focus fire.
And Dendi does not want to waste it on the tower without the egg, so he just pokes. He gets caught again by an ice path. Again, the breathe fire. Again, the dragon battle rages. But one man's a man, and one of these others a dragon loaded there. Does get the good chrono, though. Off with Nigera. He'll go down quickly and gets dropped into the middle of Alliance. Can they burst it? They will. Alliance holding the high ground. Turning on the Navi. General down. Archstyle as well. They spring the trap. They only got a one-man chrono, but that was all they needed.
Oh, that egg is really useless versus double BKB from Alliance. It just... I don't even know how long things saved up. And that was a solo Chronosphere on Timbersaw. He has Bloodstone and he's fairly tanky. No reactive armor stacks up on him. Not that it really mattered for him in the end, but now it's back to that point where they can't take the Chrono combo.
So what do you do? How do you tank it?
Some people just tank it through Aegis's. I think you only have the Windranger up very far up in front so that the Void can't possibly get to you without a Blink Dagger, which he does not possess at the moment. You can also tank it through having BOTs and a high charge Bloodstone on Timbersaw, so you can just TP back into the fight. But it's only gonna be a limited amount of time before Faceless Void gets even bigger and can go Refresher to counter these methods.
Yeah, Loda now building towards the BKB, grabbing the recipe here. Already has the hammer. Actually could buy it now if he wanted to, but might be preferring to save for buyback as one really bad fight could end up costing him the next throw shirt, possibly a lane of Rex.
Mm-hmm. I think Navi could also build like a Glimmer Cape. It's really good versus the Skywrath Mage. That's why, mostly why the, I think the hero fell out of favor. And then the Pipe Aura, which Deyura just recently completed, will be good. And AC, Auras. And the Golem. I'm not sure if Artstyle had a Golem last fight.
No, he had a... I don't think he did,
actually. I think
actually.
He had a Triceratops.
Ancient Thunderhide. So Navi will slow it down a bit. The Aegis has been reclaimed. And we're going to reset. So we head to the 32-minute mark. Only game one. But it feels like a grueling slugfest. Not so much because of the raw number of kills, but more the back-and-forth way that they've come about with Navi coming out to an early lead, Alliance striking back.
General just picked up a gem, and he has no BKB. If he gets caught out here, it's going to be a big momentum.
He's got the high ground positioning, though. He's really in a great spot to scout out Alliance and reveal them. He quickly slithers back and will end up retreating. But Alliance, oh, the timing not quite right. Didn't actually scout them, just got nervous. So they breach high ground. The smoke continues. Navi hanging near the secret shop. Does seem like they're aware this is a possibility, as three heroes are very far back near the base. And they will successfully, for now, dodge it. Alliance coming from an unusual angle, but Navi on the right side to avoid it.
And their scan had missed. They used it near the mid T3 of Alliance, and that check in green, they knew that they were outside of the base smoking.
Roshan still a little ways off here. Maybe at least a minute, possibly four, before the big rock comes back.
Let's see if General gets his D ward. It's kind of hard to see that Observer.
Four staff solves that problem. Kills the trees. And now General moving back into the Alliance woods, and I mean, the key thing there, they hang on to the gem, Ben, and they have gotten rid of a lot of wards on the back of that as of late. Navi, they need this for the map control.
Alliance have a lot more BKBs. 1, 2, 3, Faceless Void, Brood, and Dragon Knight. And Navi only have one on the Windranger. Timbersaw, I think, needs one. He can pop it as soon as he chronos if you're fast enough. Same with Slardar. They need him alive to just keep amping after the BKBs come up.
We're still at that point where the Windranger doesn't really dish out immense physical damage. Went for the Maelstrom, just got the Ags. Doesn't have that next big, you know, MKB or Daedalus type of pickup that lets him hit extremely hard on his own. Amp damage will help, but BKBs are going to offer a lot against Navi, essentially rendering Deyura useless if they get off.
He didn't put out that much damage before the BKBs, actually, so I don't think it's that big of a problem for him.
He's been kind of quiet as an impact this game. We saw him earlier getting caught by the Chrono, but I mean, more importantly, like Timbersaw, normally you pick him for damage.
He's the EGM.
You pick him to frontline.
Navi.
If he frontlines, that's a lot more farm on him, though.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how he's supposed to build up his reactive armor stacks before the fight. It was good in lane because of the Broodmother.
Hope the Bulldog feeds you spiderites.
Some people just take neutrals and don't kill them. You just sit there for 15 seconds, building up max stacks. That makes a big difference in fights.
Yeah, Alliance, they do have a lot of magic damage, but that's where the pipe comes in a bit.
Yeah.
As they smoke again.
Even the HP regen. If you have the pipe HP regen and then 32 HP regen from max stacks.
Oh, this could be huge. It's going to be a very quick Roshan respawn, and Slardar ends up getting called out. General! Oh boy, gem down as Fort pops a celebratory BKB at the tail end of that.
You don't expect the Slardar to be alone like that with a gem. So that's why he pops his BKB, and that's not a good time. Navi not really playing that tight around the Roshan respawn.
And no buyback.
Yeah, 9:15 post.
It looks to be Alliance's first and just a straight up free Roshan of the game. But they are a bit slow as far as this goes until Bulldog comes in. So they are going to congregate here in the pit, but Na'Vi showing signs that they might want to take a fight. This is where the egg can be devastating, even if you have BKBs, if they can't get to it. Gem just marking Alliance's territory here down in the pit, letting Na'Vi know that this area is under their control, but Sineko is zoning them back with the Fire Spirit to find time for the Slardar respawn as they barely clip Artstyle here. They commit onto him. Loda spending a lot of time working on a very tanky support chain, but Dendi's the real grab, and that's the one that S4 catches out. BKBs aplenty have been popped by Alliance, but it's gotten them two critical kills around the pit, and they come back in. No buyback on Dendi. They won't have their prize Windrager, but who needs her when you've got Sunray? General onto Ake, does get off the crush, but Sineko, the bigger prize, brought down by the chain stun of Loda together with S4. They work on Dingera. He is getting some stacks out. He chains, but he ends up just getting set back, and he chains back into the fight. Dingera all over the place with this one. But Alliance, more importantly, they're hitting Roche, and Roche can't move, can't be sent home, can't go anywhere.
And the Blink Dragon Knight making a huge difference in that fight. First picking out the Slardar, and then picking off the Windranger before she is able to get her BKB off. And Alliance, now they have a huge threat in the DK. They don't need the Void to set up for fights.
Oh, they might get the Chen Army here as well. They have the level 3 Dragon Knight Ultimate. Alliance coming into their own. As we hit the 37-minute mark, it's been a sequence of very costly deaths, and now big items piling in on the tail end of it. They have an MKB up to deal with the Windrunner. She can't just pop Windrun when Bulldog goes on her and expect to survive. Positioning will be of the utmost importance. At the same time, Greaves, grabbed by EGM despite all the deaths. He's ahead of that Phoenix, ahead of Sineko at 38 minutes.
I think General probably regrets his four staff pickup. He knows that he needs BKB for these fights.
He's got three mobility items.
You need the supports to build, like the Glimmer Capes, the four staffs, and then he needs to be able to tank up. All three cores need to be able to withstand the Chronosphere, or even a DK stun, but Slaughter can't even stand up to the DK stun at this point.
Man, it's such a low cooldown initiation, and one of the big reasons why the hero has come back into the meta.
And instant.
And often unscouted. Na'Vi, it's been quiet here from Artstyle after a fantastic start. You can see the graphs reflecting it. He's stagnated. He's gone for the Hyperstone. Probably wants that Assault Cuirass, but it's a long journey to grab it. Bulldog, long having since completed his own, now moving towards his endgame. Skullbasher will be next. An Alliance muscling up mid. It's going to be Na'Vi's turn to whip up a miracle here in the base defense, as they will lose the tier 2 mid. The bottom lane slowly pushing against Alliance, but I don't think it's moving at a rate sufficient to force them back, and we do see Alliance hold ground, continue to pressure. They let the Frost Dragon out. There comes an early, a very early pop on the glyph there. Alliance, having seen that, will stick around. Nobody from Na'Vi back. The whole team in the base. No split push, no counterplay, just a head-on fight brewing. Will they get that Miracle Shackle? Will the Chrono be off the mark? Na'Vi praying for a Lotosphere.
General has a really tough time jumping.
And there's the Shackle. It's a long-range one. It's the catapult that works against Loda. Quickly drops the egg. Loda pops the BKB. They just beat it down. Then the follow-up Chrono. It's the right kind of Loda Sphere for Alliance. The one that might end Na'Vi's hopes in game number one. General, very low. He's got Shadow Blade out. S4 is in caught. The secondary Shackle work is magic, but they get on to Dendi. He's been sent on by Artstyle. The Duke's to Ice Path isn't enough. I think he makes it out of this one, Ben. They haven't gotten the racks. They end up being forced back just with the Dragon Knight death. It looked like a pretty good fight from Alliance there, but they just didn't have the finishing power.
Well, then he took so long to kill that Dragon Knight. He has a ton of armor, and then he popped the cheese. He was on him for a good 10 seconds throughout the fight, and a pretty decent chrono from Faces Void over there.
It really was a good one. They kill the egg, and right as the egg dies, he pops the chrono on two. They almost got General, just didn't get that extra bash. He barely makes out of range, courtesy of the Shadow Blade, and Na'Vi, after a very tentative hold, they're immediately hunting for kills. A deep movement forward by General to the bottom lane. He might just jump EGM here, but EGM's a bit tanky.
If he walks up that hill, maybe.
And General waiting for the backup to arrive. Timbersaw on his way, Dendi too. So all three Na'Vi cores taking up position in the Alliance woods.
I think Loda could have played far more forward in that fight. He did have the Aegis and popped the BKB for his first life, making sure that he wouldn't get stunned before he popped his Chronosphere, but opting to back off as soon as S4 died. Maybe it wasn't so bad.
There's the Shadow Blade movement. General just constantly on patrol. Na'Vi, just one slight hold, but instantly their spirits are buoyed and they're playing a lot more confidently. Still full Alliance, though, have the Aegis, and we're gonna see Loda able to hold on to that for about another minute. Is that minute long enough for Alliance to march back down mid? Do they try for a push again here, or do they just have to reset?
I think they can just reset. They can just wait for MKB coming out on Faces Void, and then Dendi is gonna die in the Chronosphere, BKB or not.
Well, they are grouping up mid. Looks like they may at least poke. Bulldog nuking the wave, increasing the number of progeny he has on the map. And the army does start to grow, but Alliance don't really want to go in. So they're content just with a bit of lane pressure. They retreat back towards the pit. You can see that they're really debating it here. They want to get a ward down for Ake, and the whole team will follow him as he plants it. He just now reclaimed, so if they go high ground, it will be without that extra life. And there is still a tier 2 bottom.
I don't think there's a big rush for them. I still wonder where Faces Void is going to go. Whether he wants like a refresher, although he doesn't have a mana pool to support it at this point. Especially with two activatable items, Manta and Mjolnir, that take a lot of mana.
Art Style is turning into Carry Chen now. Gets the AC at 43 minutes. A big pickup here, especially against Bulldog, just to at least negate his. But how long the Chen lives, that's a question to be determined. Na'Vi pushing out the lane, and they are going for the wraparound. They're smoked, and under cover of it, heading straight, beelining really, towards Alliance. It's Loda in the trees. Do they get a good crush? He's the gem carrier. They jump Loda. Dendi's ready as well. The BKB coming through. Loda just melting. Dendi might kill him off the bat. He does end up getting off the chrono on the general, and they will possibly lose Dendi. And Loda survives through it all. Just walks away. Cool guys don't look back at explosions, and Loda looks very cool right now. Four drop. Na'Vi forced to throw out a buyback here on Dendi. How did they not kill Loda in that fight?
It's the Alliance four staff. We saw it in the matchup versus Mineski, saving in the base defense. And again, Ake casting on Loda so that he can pop his BKB, time walk some of the damage off, and get that big Chronosphere to win them the team fight.
And the living legend coming back to life here in a critical moment. 23 to 20, they begin their siege. They're down three heroes on the side of Na'Vi, and Dit-Yara basically sacrifices his own life just to stall. It doesn't allow Dendi to get a crucial kill in S4. Alliance have abandoned their brother, and they will suicide the Timbersaw. So no gold, but now Dendi, he's out too far. That's a dieback on the Dendi bot, and Alliance, this might just be it. They've got 100 seconds to go without the Windranger. Exposed racks, mid and bottom. Could easily be two lanes, possibly Megas. Maybe they even tried to throw it. Or maybe they just run away. It might not be a Windranger, but the rest of the Na'Vi squad is back. Abyssal complete on Bulldog. A fully six-slotted Brood Mama. Honda General, just a couple of pokes. The Spider spreads her legs, and the Bulldog Broodmother continues the rack of kills to have a huge impact in the late game. Doing it again here in game one. Alliance close in. The Swedes, they're almost there. They just need one or two more kills. Or at least for Na'Vi not to come and defend. Dit-Yara decides to. That may cost him. BKB's out. Dit-Yara down. That's all three cores dead, and Alliance have all but sealed it. Na'Vi have nothing but under-farm supports to defend the base. They'll rotate to top. They want the Megas. Slow and steady. Alliance just outlasting Na'Vi in these critical engagements. Bit by bit, inch by inch, they zero in. A very futile egg comes out, marking where the Na'Vi base once stood. But the hordes have reassembled, and they are looking for this final lane of Rex. No split push, no hope in sight. Alliance may lay down. Ranged is all that remains, and there's the GG. Alliance, they start to put the crown back on here in game one. They're out to a 1-0 lead.
Man, if you look at Chen's net worth at the end of the game, he had 15,000, whereas he was maybe like 6,000 above the Slaughter. Just not enough farm on Slaughter, not enough farm on Dit-Yara, and I must say, I favor Na'Vi a lot more when they have Dit-Yara on a farming core, like Faceless Void or Lone Druid, like we saw a little bit earlier, but no one was making plays on Na'Vi.
And they had two big playmaking heroes here. The Slaughter, who was making them a bit in the mid game, but when he lost the gem, it felt like they everything just dried up from there.
His blink was too slow, his BKB was non-existent, and Bulldog, the true carry.
Yeah, the Bulldog Broodmother continues its very impressive run, and it's, yeah, Broodmother can win a lot of games. We saw that, like, going back to ESL 1 New York at the end of last year. Can take them over, but